It's really getting out of hand, isn't it? Fortunately, we're keeping pace with it. So, today, there was a great breakthrough. Something that's the trickiest of all tricks, I think, was when the ego tells us that we cannot help others unless we feel are experiencing their suffering and their trouble, etc. Well, if we're experiencing their confusion, we're going to be confused ourselves. You cannot be both clear and confused. It's not possible. You can alternate between the two, but then you teach a mixed message, very mixed message. So I was able to see the falsity of the statement, and it's a little difficult to explain it, but it is possible to see it. It's clearly wrong, clearly mistaken, but it's a vicious, vicious thing, because really, I can say my suffering has been to try to relate to those who are suffering so I can give them the right information. You see, it's the goal remains the same, whether, no matter what type of suffering is there. So, same goal, same way of solving the continuity problem. Our problem is the same for everyone. Everyone has the same problem. The remedy is the same for everyone. So why do you have to experience their other suffering? For how does that change? Does it change what the goal is? No. Does it change what the problem is? No. Does it change what the means to reach the goal? Does it change that? No. It doesn't change anything. It's going to be the same whether you suffer or not. And they say, well, you can't assess the fear levels to help them out. Well, the what needs to be done is the same regardless of fear levels. If high fear levels mean this, people will delay more, sure. But what has to be accepted is the same. It's not going to change. It doesn't matter how much fear there is there. It just means they may take a little longer. That's all. And it's up to the Holy Spirit to assess people's fear, our fear levels, and what needs to be said, etc., etc. That's not our responsibility. So we definitely don't need to suffer. We don't need to experience what others are experiencing. Now, we're often told, especially like in music, that you can't really relate to produce music for your audience unless you are feeling what they feel, or unless you have lived the music and all this kind of stuff. So the thing is to, like, for instance, you can't play the blues unless you've really suffered, that kind of stuff. I was grew up on all that stuff, and I always said, nah, there's something phony about that. But it's so prevalent that a musician thinks that they must, you know, be in pain and in suffering and all this stuff, and then they can express it through their music, and then their audience will say, ah, yes, they truly know what they're talking about, and this is some kind of therapy that's taking place. Well, but it's not any therapy related to salvation at all. So it's something entirely else. It's nothing to do with salvation. Salvation has to do with accepting the fact that what you are can't suffer. So if you're suffering, obviously you haven't accepted salvation, so how can you be teaching it, really? Here we are engaging in inquiry, looking at this. But the higher level is to actually accept the vision of the inner Christ, which says what we are cannot suffer. Now, the vision, the inner Christ sees the world and sees us differently than we see the world and how we see ourselves and others. So we can exchange our perception for the vision of the inner Christ, and that then we will have this perception that will be shared with us. The inner Christ will share its perception with us, and then we will see, what I am has never suffered and can never suffer, has never died and can never die. And this is what we need to share with others, is say, hey, this is what I'm experiencing. This is what I'm being seen by the Christ, inner Christ. The inner Christ is seeing me in a different way. I'm being seen in a different way. I'm aware of that. And so are you. You're all being seen in a different light. So there is not any need to suffer whatsoever in order to help others. This is the great deception of the ego. If we look back on our life and we're ready to pass away, we might say, oh, you know what? I was fooled. My whole life I was fooled. I thought I needed to suffer to help others. I never really helped anybody. And all I did was just suffer needlessly and uselessly, wasted my whole life. This is the hardball tactics that the ego used. So I was finally able to get a high degree of clarity about this. It's still not, you know, pinned down entirely, but we'll see how this progresses. I just noticed that, oh, okay, this is completely bogus. There's no need to suffer whatsoever. I can see why this is bogus, and it's just like, it was just a sort of a simple, clear seeing of this. But I understood that the route is super important, but you know, you have to, even the super important insights, you have to just, you know, say, okay, all right, this is a super important. It's like game 7 of the World Series. You say, okay, this, you know, this just another game, you know, just stay within yourself. Do what you know you can do well. Do it well. Stay poised. Don't try to, you know, get outside yourself or anything. You can go that way. You just have to say, okay, don't jump at it. Don't try to bottle it. Pickle it, can it, depict it, make a song about it, do anything. Don't try to do anything with it. Just kind of say, okay, I see that, okay, that's important. And stay calm. So that's what I've done. But clearly, if this can be solved, then suffering is going to be over. If you can see that you don't need to suffer in order to help others, then you can certainly drop your suffering, no question about it. But we don't drop our suffering because we think that this enables us to be compassionate. And that's not true at all. Compassionate to others is to reassure them that what they are cannot suffer. That's compassion. When you're suffering, you're simply reassuring everyone that what we are can suffer, which is completely the wrong message. So it's not helping. It's not being compassionate at all. Suffering is not being compassionate. Feeling what others are feeling is not being compassionate. Because again, it doesn't matter what they're feeling at all. What matters is that they accept themselves as being seen by the inner Christ in the light of that what we are cannot suffer. So it doesn't matter. Sickness, death, everything that's taking place in the world doesn't matter at all, because none of it's happening to what we are. What we are is not suffering any of this. And it's that which we need to accept. Okay. By not accepting it, we are saying what we are can suffer, which is a lie. Which comes from our desire to be greater than God and to get rid of reality. Okay, so we're insisting that reality can suffer and can die. Not true. So we're saying, yes, reality can suffer. And the inner Christ child says, no. Reality cannot suffer. Cannot. So in Christian Science, the essence of that, when there's a sickness there, the practitioner just says, you know, what you are does not have this sickness. What you are is not suffering from the sickness. It's only your desire to be something other than what you are that is presuming, the presumption that there's this sickness there. It's a desire to be sick. I mean, that's a better way to put it. Our suffering is really not suffering, but a desire for suffering. Maybe that's why Buddha said, desire is the root of all suffering. Maybe, probably, it's that simple. Because there is no suffering, there's a desire to suffer. But there is no real suffering at all. So the healing practitioner of Christian Science would simply affirm the truth that you are not suffering. And of course, it works. It worked. And in fact, you know, it was so profound that eventually the institutions and powers of the flesh said, hey, we got to get rid of this, tone it down, and you know, they're still working on that, trying to get rid of that. You can't have people knowing that they can't be sick and suffering because we have all these pills we gotta sell, right? So, hey. But Christian Science was a big, big deal back in the day. Every town in America had a Christian Science reading place and reading room. I mean, it was just all spread all over, and it just kind of, you know, withered as this the new modern high tech biotechnology and all that stuff, as that has come in. It's trying to push everything out of the way. It's the bully. It's really the new bully on the block. Very much so. But what we are cannot suffer. You can't bully Christ. Christ cannot be bullied. And Christ knows what we are cannot suffer. So we have that within us which cannot be bullied. But somehow we're made to feel wrong about that, like we're nuts or something. Of course, the big pharma would love for us to be labeled as nuts if we believe that what we are cannot suffer, be sick. That's their aim and objective. That's called the Antichrist objective. So now you see what Antichrist means: against the certitude of Christ within us, saying, hey, you don't have that certitude within you, and if you do, it's completely crazy. That's Antichrist, anti-certitude that what we are cannot suffer. That's the agenda of the world that's in place. That's probably what that lady Diane Reedy in the House of Congress when she jumped up and said, hey, you cannot serve two masters, you know, and they hauled her away and gave her a mental evaluation. You know, she was just pointing something out here. Hey, this is the Antichrist, you know, and you can't have it both ways. And I guess she has seen over the years how they're, you know, the sophists are trying to have it both ways, and you cannot. So I think that was the most interesting situation about the whole drama in Washington. Was we now know that those who, you know, speak up are labeled mental cases or something. That's the new in vogue thing from the Antichrist agenda. But anyway, we can absolutely drop the false belief that we're supposed to suffer in order to help others. Absolutely not true. Just the opposite. If we want to help others, drop the suffering. Drop the suffering. As Eckhart Tolle would say, drop the pain body. Right? Drop the suffering. Drop the pain body. If you really want to help others. Because then it starts to dawn on them, oh, maybe what we are can't suffer. Maybe I'm only trying to suffer. I'm desiring to suffer. And I'm suffering from my desire to suffer, as it were. You know, that's the only thing. It's my desire to be prime creator that is causing me to feel weird. Really weird. And we can drop this weirdness that we call suffering. Whatever, you know, it's this very weird. We shouldn't think that we know what it is. It's desire, really. It's just desire. We shouldn't label you have this illness and that and that and that and that, all this stuff. No, it's all just one desire to be prime creator. And it expresses itself in a weirdness, in a whimsical weirdness, which can seem to take on infinite variety in our effort to kind of get comfortable with it. But it's all just the same one desire, really. The I is just a desire to unseat God. That's what the I is. It's a desire to be an I. It's not I, it's a desire to be so. It's a wish, it's a wanting, a will, a wanting to be an I, to be another self, to learn how to die, all this stuff. And we keep just kind of moving around, trying to get comfortable. And as we do that, it seems to take on different facets. But it's all the same, just one desire there. So, again, I've said over the years that the goal of the Antichrist, of what's happening in the world, is to label people who are listening to the Holy Spirit, clarify the truth about suffering and desire, label them as crazy, as mental cases, and force them into treatment, etc., etc. That is the objective, because the objective of the Antichrist is to turn everyone on the planet away from the Holy Spirit, away from the inner Christ consciousness, the perfect no, which tells us no, we can't suffer. That is the agenda, and they are pursuing it frantically, and without any shame whatsoever. And these minds are—they're caught up in communicating with machines. That's the problem. We know that Google, for instance, is pushing voice recognition as the future. Very, very important. This is the big push. This is the next big thing: is voice recognition from gadgets and machines. And people are more and more finding themselves relating to gadgets and machines and etc. Talking. They think they're talking to a person or something. This is an extremely bad road to go down. Extraordinarily bad road to go down. Cuts out the Holy Spirit altogether. There's no Holy Spirit in a gadget, in a machine. Okay. So, person-to-person talk is way superior to person-to-machine talk. The more we talk to machines, the more like we come like machines. We will find ourselves adjusting to the machines. We will find ourselves adjusting to the machines. And those who do not will seem completely antiquated and weird in mental cases, you know. The ones who are calling people mental cases, who talk about the Holy Spirit, etc., those are people who have adjusted and dumbed themselves down to machines to such an extent they're not able even to function in that way. They're the real mental cases, actually. They're the ones that need therapy. And they need to get away from their relating to machines in terms of communication, and contemplate within and start realizing the true greatness that we are, which has nothing to do with machines, nothing to do with bodies either. So, I mean, body, person to person, that too is things get dumbed down. But then person to machine, that dumbs it down even more. You know, the machine to machine is even more, etc., etc. So we're going in the world's going in the wrong direction, period. Satsang is a higher way of communication. It's above person to person, because we have a situation there where there's someone who is in tune with the Holy Spirit, and others who are allowing themselves to experience this, and that's a higher form of communication, actually. So that's where the world should be going to towards inquiry, towards looking. I just realized today, as I'm listening to the radio, I have never heard in my whole life anyone toss a spiritual aside out on the radio, listening to all the various programs, you know, and just actually. Other than if you're going to like target some, you know, serious radio channel of someone talking on the radio, a preacher, minister, pastor, whatever. I'm talking about just the mainstream, you know, radio stations, the news, the weather, sports, the music, and everything. Disc jockeys talking. Never have they ever tossed out an aside, like a spiritual aside, you know, drop the name, you know, Paramahansa Yogananda. I remember when Paramahansa Yogananda was talking about his master, you know, and you know, drop, you know, it should be part of everyday conversation. The history of satsang and inquiry and looking should be part of everyday conversation on television, on radio, in book, just everyday lingo and talk. And people should be educated and be able to drop those names and say, hey, yeah, oh yeah, we're like me to the conversation. We'll say, oh yeah, Ramana says something about that. Didn't That is culture. That is culture. The rest of the stuff is not culture. It's anti-culture. I grew up, fortunately, I grew up in a family. My dad was super versed in all the spiritual history and lore and stuff. So, I mean, we'd be talking, we'd be just dropping all these tidbits. Oh, yeah, this Zen master said that, and this, you know, this Sufi said this, and this, and everything was peppered and salted with all this insight in cluing each other into the higher truth, the higher truth, the higher truth, you know. Very nice. Really, if you know anyone like that, it's very fortunate, actually. Very fortunate. That's real culture. The other stuff is anti-culture or counter-culture. You know, we live in a counter-culture world that is pulling us down into machine stupidity. Machine stupidity. Animal stupidity first. We've been pulled down to animal nature, animal stupidity, and now we're being pulled down to machine stupidity. and you know, people have all this trivial knowledge on these TV shows, trivia shows. You know, has anyone ever asked on a trivia show about the spiritual, you know, satsang and spiritual masters and all that? No, it's persona non grata everywhere in this world, just about, is persona non grata. What's the 2013? Well, you can say Ananda Maima was 17 years old. 100 years ago, she was 17 years old, and she would have just moved to Bhajatpur and started the Leela of Sadhana there. And you know, people should know these things, should be educated about the great, great teachers in history, because their lives are incredible. Absolutely, mind-blowingly, miraculously incredible. Because when you accept that what you are cannot suffer, you step into the eternal now, as it were. And your life becomes miraculous to those who are still in time, because they can't understand. They can't understand because you don't have the future anymore. I mean, and we can't afford the future. I can't afford the future. Who can afford the future right now? If you look at the future, who can afford it? Nobody can afford it, really. I certainly can't afford the future, so I have to drop the future for the now. Drop the future for the now. And then life becomes miraculous to those who are in time. But not to the one in the now. Not at all. Not at all. It's just that they know that there is no suffering. And that just projected, that it radiates out. And then others around them find that their suffering starts diminishing. and they say, oh, it's a miracle, it's a miracle. No, they're just starting, something within them says, yeah, that's right, I can't suffer. Oh, yeah. What am I doing suffering? I'm just a desire. I don't desire that so much anymore. So it eases off in some ways. So people say, oh, miracles, miracles, miracles. Yeah. Not really. That's just a way of talking about collapsing time, as it were, saving time. But nothing's being changed as far as what is or whatever, what's going on. No, it's just not understood. It's not understood. So we have what's called spiritual illiteracy. I'd say the planet now is almost spiritually illiterate. Severely. And what we're being taught in school, what I found was a spiritual illiteracy. So I went into school very literate, and I came out of school very illiterate, actually. And I had to, you know, I had to make huge efforts to keep my literacy going, because nobody cared, nobody was interested. And they said, what are you spending time on this nonsense for? You're supposed to, you know, be getting ready for the corporate world, another university, and surely they'll teach, you know, spiritual literacy there. Oh, no, they don't there either, you know. So, And it's fallen down so far that even I am, you know, somewhat illiterate as far as I can't tell you the lineages of various lineages and, you know, all this stuff. It's just the lack of interest is like a black hole here. So what we have to do is focus on what's vitally important. So that's okay. And what's vitally important is we don't have to suffer to help others. In fact, by suffering, we're not helping others. By dropping our suffering, which is really desire to suffer, by dropping our desire to suffer, accepting the Christ child's vision of what we really are, that we know we're perfect, we cannot suffer, we cannot die, then we are assuring others that this is true, this is a fact, and this is true, and they can experience it also. And then that starts lifting the burden off of others. That's true compassion, okay? True compassion, true culture. So there again, let's have true compassion and a true culture, and let's do it right now before things get the Antichrist, before the Antichrist just goes completely bonkers, which is getting very close to doing so, as a matter of fact. And we don't want to be caught by that maelstrom, that is for sure. Okay. All right. Very great. That's it for this one.